Flowers for Algernon, which is our first serious drama, which these kids have put a lot of time and commitment into, and I think you're going to really enjoy it. A few comments that I wanted to do is that there's a few times when Charlie is looking back, and so it's his past, so you kind of have to sort through some scenes that way. And I ask that you hold your applause till the end. I'm not going to lie, it's a longer play, and so we'll have like a 5-minute intermission if you need to, but it's going to go quick. There are some bathrooms right outside the door to the left here. There's just two of them. And then if you go down the hall by the grindhouse, that's where our big bathrooms are. So I don't have a lot to say other than that I'm super proud of these kids and what they've accomplished. So, Michael, you have something to say for us?
Yes. I just wanted to say that I have been blessed with the role of Charlie, who is the lead role. And because of this, many people come up to me after the play and like, oh my gosh, you're so amazing, and like, blah, 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 and all this stuff. Thank you, but I really could never have done it without any of these guys who are backstage. Give a holler backstage. These guys are where it's at. I love them all. I'm so glad that I got to work with them. And really, when I get to do a scene, it's them that really brings out the best in me. So that's just what I wanted to say. Thank you, guys.
And Kinsey has been my senior assistant this year, helping get things together and helping with the play, and she's going to open in prayer.
Okay, first I'd like everyone to turn off your phones pretty please. I know some plays like this can get kind of boring, but if you please ask you for respect of us actors and people around you that you don't get on your phone, and if you need to, please exit yonder and just enjoy. So, we bow our heads. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much that everyone got here in one piece with the Rhodes. And just thank you so much for this amazing opportunity to have this cast and our director, and just this opportunity to share this message that goes out to our love, Lord. And just thank you for everything. Be with us in the cast as we do our lines, that we get them right, and get our emotions correct. And just be with the audience as they open up and absorb what we are delivering, Lord. In your name we pray. Amen.
Portions of his brain, allowing them to produce brain proteins at a supernormal rate. You're right. It is too complicated for a layman to understand.
If it's successful, the operation would increase the patient's mental capacity, perhaps to the level of a genius. We have every reason to believe that it would happen quite rapidly.
A genius? And he'll stay that way permanently?
We have every reason to believe so.
It's worked so far on Algernon.
Who's Algernon?
That's what my lab technician is calling the mouse.
What would happen if the operation isn't a success?
Well, his intelligence might not change at all. It might increase temporarily, or it might make it worse.
What would happen then?
He would be taken care of.
How?
Miss Kinnion, we would not proceed with this operation unless we were reasonably sure of success. However, we are aware of the slight possibility of failure, and Rebecca Foundation, which is sponsoring us, has taken steps to secure the patient's future in that event.
Perhaps I shouldn't have brought Charlie here.
Miss Kinnion says inevitably some danger involved in experiments like this, but in every scientific advance, there has to be someone who's first.
I know that. It's rather upsetting when the first person isn't some faceless nobody in a newspaper, but it's someone you know, someone you care about.
If we are successful, then Charlie will have more than a new life. He will have a life, and even if we fail, we will have made a greater contribution to mankind than most people do in their lifetimes.
No, it's just, Charlie's like a lovable little boy. All he wants, all he ever talks about is to be smart. And he's quite incapable of making a decision like this on his own. And I brought it upon myself to... I just hope I'm doing the right thing.
All right, Charlie, just make yourself comfortable.
You want I should open my mouth and say ah?
Why would I want that?
That's doctors. Open mouth and say ah.
Oh, Charlie, I'm not a doctor.
Oh, you got a white coat.
Well, that's because I'm working in a laboratory. Now, just relax.
It hurts when they say relax.
Oh, it won't hurt, Charlie.
I know. I got my rabbit's foot.
Good. Now we're just gonna run some tests.
When I was a kid, I always failed tests.
Well,
you know, in school.
Well, this is a different kind of test. This is called a shock test.
Shock?
Yes. You look at this card and you tell me what you see.
That's the test.
Yes, Charlie. Now, look at this. What might this be? People see all kinds of things in these ink blots. What might it be for you?
Somebody spilled an ink on a white card.
People see ink blots. Pictures in these ink blots, Charlie.
Pictures?
Imagine there's something there.
Oh. I imagine... I imagine an ink blot.
Come on, Charlie. Pretend it's something.
I pretend.
Yes?
I pretend somebody spilled an ink all over this part.
All right, Charlie. Let's do the other one.
I don't see no pictures.
No, this is a sort of race. Doris, will you bring an Algernon?
Right away, Bert.
See, there are these little alleyways here, and the house starts here. He needs to get through all the holes in all the walls and get to the end here. That makes him rebellious. Then he gets a prize. Some cheese.
No mouse is Mouse was so smart.
Well, you see, this has had a lot of advantages.
Does this mean I won't get the operation?
Oh.
Because I lost?
Oh, no. This was just to test your perception, to test you.
Because I can do better. I really want that operation. I want to be smart. And I ain't afraid of that operation. I ain't afraid of nothing because I'm very strong and I always do good.
I know, Charlie. We'll have to see what Professor Beaver says.
And besides, I got my rabbit's foot.
I don't know. I simply don't know.
He didn't do too well on the tests.
Well, a man with a 68 IQ, you don't expect the answers you'd get from Dr. Salk.
He passed the physical. The doctor said he was as strong as a horse.
This isn't a trial for the Olympic team. This is a serious scientific experiment.
I know Charlie is not what you wanted for your new breed of intellectual superman, Professor, but people of his low mentality are hostile and uncooperative. They're usually dull, apathetic, and hard to reach.
But Charlie's good-natured, interested, and eager to learn.
This is not a popularity contest either. He will be the first human being ever to have his intelligence increased by surgery.
Exactly. Where will we find another retarded adult with his tremendous motivation to learn?
Please, let's use him, Professor.
Why does it mean so much to you?
Because it means so much to Charlie, you can feel it. If this project's gonna succeed, it'll succeed with Charlie Gordon.
All right, maybe you're right. We will use him.
You got lots of friends, and you won't ever be lonely all by yourself. by yourself all the time.
You will, Charlie, in time. Now, see, I brought you a present.
Gee, thanks. What is it?
It's a notebook, and every day I want you to write in it.
Write what?
Well, we'll call it a progress report.
A progress report?
No. Progress report. I want you to put the date on the top and write down everything you think and feel and remember from the past every day.
I don't remember so good.
Do the best that you can. It's very important. By reading this, we'll know what's going on in your mind.
But I don't know what's going on in my mind, so how can you?
Just take my word for it. Just do it.
I'd like to check his motor responses. Charlie, do you feel able to walk?
Yeah, I've been walking good since the operation. I could always walk good.
Would you take him for a walk down the corridor, right?
Sure, Doctor. Come on, Charlie.
Oh, Doctor?
Yes?
Can I go back to work soon?
You want to?
Yeah. See, my friends at the bakery and we have lots of fun. And maybe I could find my mom and dad. You see, my mom always wanted me to be smart. And maybe they won't send me away no more when they saw how smart I got.
We'll see, Charlie. Go along with Bert now.
Okay.
Come on, Charlie.
Hey, Bert, after Algernon's operation, do you have to walk in like this?
So, do you think we should send him back to work?
I think in a few days, sir. He seems perfectly normal.
Yes, but what about the tests? The therapy? The progress report?
He'll have to come back to the center after work. I can see him for therapy and Bert to continue the tests. 2 hours a night should do it. The progress reports he'll have to do on his own time.
Do you think it's too much activity for him? After all, he has had a serious operation.
I think, on the whole, it is better this way. We don't want to change his environment completely all at once. He likes it at the bakery. His friends are there.
Suppose he doesn't want the therapy. Suppose he doesn't want to come to the tests.
Charlie will want to. Besides good pay, and there's money in the budget for that.
I suppose you're right. Oh, one thing though. We should warn Charlie not to tell anyone the exact nature of the operation. It might... people might not understand. It might make life even more difficult. And after all, we don't want his friends thinking as though he was some sort of freak.
Which, of course, is what we might have made him.
Well, that's not a scientific attitude, Doctor.
I'm sorry. Sometimes I slip back and think like a human being.
What we have done, if it works, will push forward the boundaries of human knowledge and will help untold numbers of people.
I know. It seems that the man's life is a more delicate thing to deal with than us.
March 15th. Progress report. I mean, progress report. When I waked up this morning, I thought I was gonna be smart right away, but I'm not. Maybe it didn't work, and they'll give up on me. At least that way I won't have to run the stupid bases anymore. I hate Algernon. I mean, it's not his fault he's a smart mouse. He had the same operation as me. I could probably do the maze faster than a regular mouse. Bert says don't be Bert said it took a long time. Algernon got smart. They said that I can go back into work today, but I dasn't tell nobody what kind of operation they done, or they might laugh at me. Your friend, Charlie Gordon.
Frank, what did you do with my affairs, Frank?
I build them like you told me. How many times have I gone build them?
What's with all the screaming? You'll frighten away my customers. This shouldn't happen.
Miss Donner, with a second rate like Frank, I don't need it. What you do? We're filled angry down the street.
I filled the rods that you there.
Yeah, you'll fill them with lemon meringue pie filling.
How many times have I had to tell you, Frank? Your mind doesn't work.
What mind? You pulled the real Charlie Gordon that time.
You shouldn't say that. He's one of God's creatures. Gina, go make a sign. It should say special lucky cream players. There, it's all settled.
And what am I going to do with all that meringue?
Hey, speak of the devil. It's Charlie. Charlie Darwin, why? Would you like a cup of coffee, chili donut in the oven, maybe?
You're looking good, kid. What did they do, Charlie? Who's on crazy?
Look who's got a big mouth. Big union operation. You'll put the customer where it belongs.
Come on, Frank. We've got six birthday games. Try to remember this time. Were they spelled with an I?
That's how you're back, Charlie. They then got pep talks. You're gone.
Thanks, Frank.
You're really looking for Charlie? What'd they do to you?
Well, they put me to sleep, and then they operationed on me.
You're right.
I'm okay, Mrs. Darn. I'm ready to work. Where's the deliveries at?
Gina, go make a sign. Charlie, darling, you're not going to be delivering anymore.
But I always deliver.
And deliver good. Never a mistake. But while you were gone, I needed somebody to drive a cake for me. I got a nice boy. Hurry. You'll like him. So I thought that you could rest up from your operation and sleep up like you always did, and Ernie will drag.
I'm okay, Ms. Donner, really. I can do the deliveries and clean up. What do you need an Ernie for?
He needs the money, Charlie. And I'll keep you on as an apprentice to learn him to be bigger and to you to be his assistant. Help him when he needs it, you know, Thanksgivings and Saturdays.
I never was an assistant before.
Charlie, how long have you been here? 17 years. Charlie, 17 years ago, your Uncle Herman brought you to my Sam, God rest his soul, and asked him to let you work here, to look after you. And when your Uncle Herman died, and your mom finished you that warm place, Sam got you out. He signed for you. And Sam's promise is my promise. From this business, I will never be a millionaire. But you've got a job here for the rest of your life.
Thanks, Mrs. Donner. Mrs. Donner, do you think that I could maybe learn to be an apprentice baker like that Ernie?
Don't worry about it. Just remember, you'll never have to go back to that warm place, not on my worst enemy.
Therapy session with Dr. Strauss.
What's therapy?
Well, Charlie, Seth, is I come into your house and you lie down on your couch and you talk about what you think, what you hear, your dreams.
I don't have no dreams.
You will very soon. Seth, is let you feel bad. You talk and talking makes you feel better.
But I do plenty of talking all day and I feel fine. So what do I gotta come to therapy for?
Because we say so. Now, we're loaning you this teaching machine.
Machine? If I'm gonna be teaching, I want to go back to Miss Kinian's class.
Charlie, Miss Kinian is coming to the center to teach you specially.
Yeah? When?
Very soon.
Until then, you'll use this machine. It works something like a TV set, Charlie. It shows pictures and it talks. I want you to put it on every night before you go to sleep.
You're kidding! Why would I turn on the TV before I go to sleep?
Just do as we say, Charlie.
No! What's it gonna do?
Charlie, just do as we say!
No! Explain me why.
He's beginning with question authority.
I know. Now, Charlie, this machine can do many wonderful things for your mind. It can teach you things while you're sleeping. And as you begin to fall asleep, it will make you have dreams and make you remember things from your past.
What good is getting smart when I'm asleep? I want to get smart when I'm awake.
Charlie, you have two minds, the conscious and the subconscious. Before you go to sleep, the machine will teach your conscious mind, and while you sleep, it will stir up memories in your subconscious.
If I gotta get smart for two minds, I'm never gonna get smart.
Charlie, you're getting smarter all the time. It's like the hour hand on a clock. You can't see it, but it is moving. Very soon, you will be an extremely intelligent young man.
Use that machine.
I never learned nothing watching the late night movies. And they was more interesting than you.
Two times two is four. Two times three is six.
How am I going to get to sleep with you yelling numbers at me all night?
Two times five.
I remember my Uncle Herman was a house painter. He would paint houses in the summer and sleep on our old sofa in the parlor when he was out of work. I loved my Uncle Herman. I really loved him. I remember I once told Mom that when I grew up, I wanted to be a painter, just like my Uncle Herman. Norma, she laughed and she said, Charlie's gonna be the artist in the family. And then my dad, he slapped her face and told her not to be so nasty to her brother. I don't know what an artist is, but it must not be a nice thing if Norma said it. I always feel bad that Norma got in trouble for being mean to me. Oh, I know. When I get smart, maybe I'll go visit her.
lay in the kitchen performing the swan lay.
Look at this, Miss Donner.
I'm looking. I'm seeing, but I'm not believing. How come Charlie is working the dough mixer?
I was out to lunch. It was Frank's big idea of an April Fool's joke.
I pay you to make April Fool's an expensive engineering.
Well, Oliver quit yesterday. The machine was just sitting there. I thought it was... We're just as a human.
It took Oliver 6 months to learn, and he went to baker school.
How could Charlie?
I only know what I see. Did you get a new man?
The union said maybe next week. Do you really think he can do it?
Does it better than Oliver.
Charlie, darling, what are you doing?
I didn't mean nothing by it, Mrs. Donner. I only... Frank said that...
Nobody said you meant something, Charlie. How did you learn to do that?
I don't know. I just watched Oliver, and I done it.
I don't want to be unreligious or anything, but it's like a miracle.
Well, I told you, there is something peculiar about Charlie today.
Go take the cheesecake out of the oven. Charlie, I don't know how you done it, but it looks like you learned something. I should want you to be careful and do the best you can do. You've got a new job at a $5 raise.
I don't want a new job, Mrs. Donner. I like doing the deliveries and cleaning up and helping my friends, Frank and Joe.
Never mind your friends, Charlie. You should want to work in advance yourself.
Mrs. Donner, what's in advance?
Just forget about it, Charlie. From now on, he'll work the dough mixer. That's a thing. Frank, Mr. Riley. I should want you to make a new dough mixer. That's an April Fool's joke that backfired.
Tell me the joke, Frank. The one that backfired? Does this mean I'm getting smarter?
Ha!
Grab.
Remember things from his childhood memories and even some early days in the bakery. friends' faces or even their names.
I keep wondering what kind of people they were. I know that perfectly normal people or people with a normal mentality can have retarded children. It's just, there's such an essential goodness to Charlie, a sweetness. How could they have sent him away to the institution? He was their child.
They're all precious.
If it weren't for his uncle and Mr. Donner getting him out, he might have sunk even lower, become a vegetable. Terrible ways.
Miss Kidian! Miss Kidian!
I'll do that!
That's wonderful!
I didn't even know that I'd meet him until Brett Stellan told me, and then I got so excited!
I lost.
But then I meet him 8 times in a row!
That's excellent news, Charlie.
I must be getting smart to meet a smart mouse like that.
Yes, Charlie.
And then I asked Bert if I could hold him. I felt bad at him, and I wanted to make friends. I asked Bert if I could feed him, but he said no.
Well, Algernon he's a special mouse, Charlie. When he wants to eat, he has to solve a new problem to get his food.
How would you like to answer a question every time you got hungry?
Me? I have a PhD, Charlie.
Charlie, have you finished Robinson Crusoe?
Yeah, I liked it, but what happened to him after?
After what?
You know, after the story.
Well, I don't know. That's all there is.
But I want to know more about him.
Well, you see, Charlie, a man writes a story, and he comes to the end, and he's finished. And then he writes another story.
Well, can I read that?
What?
The other story.
There isn't another story. But here, I brought you some more books. How's everything else going?
Swell. I got an advance at bakery the other day.
Yes, I know. I've read your report.
You read them?
Yes, to help me see how you're getting on.
It's funny. I kept writing them and all, but I was never really thinking about who was reading them, or you.
Does that bother you?
Well, it's like I write about all the things I think about, and maybe some things I don't want you to know.
Charlie, you don't have to be ashamed of anything. You're a fine man, and you're going to show them all one day.
Show them what?
Oh, I guess I mean, for a person that God has given so little to, you've done a lot more than a person who has always had brains but never used them. Don't feel badly if you suddenly discover that people aren't as smart as you think they are, or as nice.
People aren't nice, Miss Kinney. You, and Professor Niemer, and Dr. Strauss, and my friends at the bakery. They're smart, and they're good, and they like me. Nobody ever did anything that wasn't nice to me before.
Finish the books, Charlie. We'll stop for today.
Is something wrong?
No, I've just got something in my eye.
April 15th. Miss Kinian is a nice lady, like my mom used to be, I think. I remember once my mom told me to always be nice to people, so that way you won't get in trouble. But you have to be careful, because if you was too nice, then they might think that you was making trouble. I remember my mom went to the hospital to bring back a new baby sister. Still don't know why you get him at the hospital. She was nice, like a doll, only she cried all the time. They put her in a crib in her room, and I remember my dad said that, "Don't worry, Charlie won't hurt her." Well, once they was in the kitchen, and I'm lying in bed, and she's crying. I only wanted to hold her, make her quiet, like Mom.
Don't you ever touch her again! You'll hurt her!
Ch-
tomorrow night. No, not tomorrow. Tomorrow, Frank and Joe are throwing me a party because I'm a new job.
Hey, Joe, put on stereo so we can dance.
How's that?
Charlie, Professor Eamer wants a workout. You've seen these cards, remember?
Of course I remember.
see all kinds of things in these ink pots. Tell me what you might see.
You mean to tell me that there aren't pictures in these ink blots?
What?
Pictures! Hidden in the ink blots! Last time, you said that everyone could see them and that you wanted me to find them too!
No, Charlie, I couldn't have said that.
What do you mean? That's what you said! Just because you're smart enough to go to college doesn't mean that you have the right to make fun of me!
No, Charlie, wait!
What's this all about? I'm sick and tired of people laughing at me! Maybe before I didn't know any better, but now I do, and I don't like it!
Charlie, someone is making fun of you.
What about these ink blots? Last time, Bert said that there were pictures in them, and that he wanted everyone to find them, and that I could find them, and I mean, I just...
Set up the tape for the first test.
Right.
Look, Charlie, do you want to hear the exact words Bert used?
The same words as I used today. Every time you run through the procedure, ask him done, each and every time.
I'll be the same. I'll believe that when I hear it.
This week, what do you see on this card? People see all kinds of things in these ink pots. Tell me what it makes you think.
Somebody spilled the ink on a white card.
Was that really me? I figured out a new way to set up the mixing machine. Mrs. Donner was very pleased. She gave me $50 as a bonus and a $5 raise, but why don't I enjoy working there anymore, doctors?
Why? You tell me.
I don't know. Frank, Joe, they ignore me. No, it's more than that. They're hostile towards me. I thought they'd be happy for me. They're supposed to be my friends. It takes all the pleasure out of working there, Doctor. Why?
So more intelligent you become, so more problems you'll have.
Why didn't you tell me this before the operation?
Would you have understood? Your intellectual growth is outstripping your emotional growth, so there's bound to be problems. That's why I'm here.
I guess I need you.
So, how are your other studies going?
Fine. The French is very easy. The German a little more difficult. I think I'd like to try Russian.
Why?
I wanted to know what War and Peace was like in the original.
You like it in English?
Yeah. I stayed up all night to finish it.
You read War and Peace in one night?
Mm-hmm.
Well, then you hardly have time for dreams.
Oh, but I do, Doctor. I don't think there's a moment of sleep that I don't dream.
About what?
Well, last night, it was Charlie. About 6 or 7 before Norman was born, he's playing with his spinner, brightly colored bead, read it on the screen, turns his bed, flashes.
Is he alone?
No, he's not. I see my mom. Her hair is up in a bun, but I can't quite make out her face yet. It's still a little shadow. My father walks in. I recognize his form, his shape, but like my mom, I can't really make out his face either. He has a letter in his hand.
The specialist sent his report. Another $25.
Don't tell me about the money. What did he say?
Same as all the rest. They say he'd be much happier.
I'm not sending him away. He's mine. There's nothing wrong with him.
There's no use pretending nothing's wrong.
He's not a dummy. He's normal. He's just like everyone else. Put that thing away. Go put him down, good luck.
Stop yelling at him. You're scaring him.
I'm scaring him? He's my son. I can make him... Are you going to be sick, Charlie? Go to the bathroom, Charlie.
You stop yelling at him. You always do this, and the poor kid...
Then why don't you help me, Matt? Every day I have to do it all by myself. I have to teach him and try to
himself, Rose. The doctors, even the teachers, say that he's not capable of doing normal work.
That teacher? That's a retarded one. Let her start with me. I'll do more than write the Board of Education.
Look at him! Look at Charlie! He's going to be sick! Sick!
Next September, he's going back to PS13 to do the terms work over again.
Sick.
Inside. Go inside.
Take him. He's frightened.
You keep at it. He's a big boy. Don't want to take care of himself. I'm not cleaning this up. You'll be punished. Bad, bad, bad.
Charlie, I think something will be on for today.
Doctor. I remember their names. She was Rose. Rose, and he was Matt. I remember their names.
Don't be hasty,
Rose. Hasty? It's like 100 years I've lived with this. What
tries.
I know he tries, but he can't. Who is she going to meet? Who could she bring into the house with someone like him?
I don't know. I think of her, and I think of him, but I think of us, Rose. What does this do to us?
Love. Don't, Charlie, finish your studies. You're changing too fast.
my feelings for you won't change just because I'm becoming more intelligent.
You're changing emotionally, too. Up to now, I've just been your teacher. You're bound to think that you're in love with me.
I see. You think that all little boys fall in love with their teacher, and emotionally, I'm still a little boy.
That's not what I said.
Then why?
Don't push me, Charlie. Every week, you're a different person. When you mature intellectually, we may not even be able to communicate. And when you mature emotionally, you may not even want me. I've got to think of myself too, Charlie.
Alice, are you pretending that I'm not here?
No. I'm trying to pretend that I don't care that you're here. But I do.
Hey, you! Stop staring at us! What are you... Get back here! Just, what are you...
Charlie, are you alright?
I'm fine. Alice, did you see him?
No, I didn't see anyone.
Standing right there. He was close enough to touch.
No, are you alright?
I'm fine! Alice, the truth. Did you see him?
It was too dark. I'm sure the
girl... I'm sorry. I better take you home. I'm trying to do a good job, Mrs. Donner. I have worked hard.
Nobody's saying your work, Charlie, but something's happened to you. And I don't understand. Not only me, but everybody. This whole place is inside out, and nobody can keep their minds on my work. Last night, I had another delegation with the staff. All I have is this business, Charlie. I have to let you go.
But I where will I go?
You know as well as me, you don't need to work here anymore.
I never worked anywhere else.
Let's face it, Charlie. You're not the same Charlie that came to my Sam 17 years ago. And you're not the 3 months ago, Charlie. You haven't told me and I know best. It's your business. It may be a miracle, who knows? But you've turned into a very smart young man. And operating a dough mixer is no job for a smart young man.
You told me that I would have a job here as long as I need it. I still need it, Mrs. Donner.
No, you don't, Charlie. If you did, I'd stick up for you against them and all of their petitions, but they're scared to death of you. They're scared or jealous, who knows? But they won't work for Charlie. All I have is my business. Come and say hello sometime.
May 24th. If they put Algernon back in the big cage with all the other mice, what would happen to him?
Too fast! You're not thinking of the project at all! You're thinking of the
my techniques in psychosurgery and enzyme injection patterns that are the important factor.
Yes, but you would never have found them if it weren't for my original theory.
Wait. What's the rush? You're like a child who can't wait to open a Christmas package.
I am not a child! I am a senior member of this project, and I say that we take Charlie and Algernon to Chicago.
June 7th. I hate the nights after the university library closes. Ever since they fired me from the bakery, I've had nightmares constantly. Last night, I walked all over town just so I wouldn't have to go home and sleep. Alice has left calls for me all over, but I can't see her. I can't see him. She'd be at the school now. I need someone to talk to. You're an ice cake machine. I like talking to you more than I like talking to Dr. Strauss. He doesn't have a race button.
Night, Miss Kinnian.
Good night.
Look, Burgess.
It's Charlie.
Hey, Charlie, where have you been? That's a nice suit.
Hello, Burgess. Alice, Miss Kinnian.
Why will Charlie be coming to school? Are you coming back, Charlie?
No. This is just a visit to stir old memories.
Gee, you hop like a big show though, Charlie.
Good night, girls. I'll see you tomorrow at 6. Good night, Miss Kinnian. Night, Charlie.
Good.
Swimming?
I had to see you.
Now? After all this time? I know you think those girls are just so retarded creatures who don't matter, but you coming here could upset them. Set back the work I do with them.
It wouldn't affect them that much. You're overreacting.
You've changed, Charlie. With all that you've gained, you've lost something you once had before. A kindness, an opening. You had a smile.
It was an empty, stupid grin.
No, a warm, real smile. Because you wanted people to like you. Now, with all your intelligence.
All right. I've changed. What did you expect? I don't have to take that kind of treatment I've had all my life.
People have not been bad to you.
What would you know about it? The best of them have been smug and patronizing.
You put me in that category too, I suppose.
Don't be stupid.
Guess I must seem rather dull-witted to you.
What's that supposed to mean?
You are destroying my self-confidence! I phoned you after the concert, not once, but a dozen times. And I've never phoned a man before. All right, Charlie Gordon, I'm not as smart as you are. I try to pretend I know what you're talking about, but I don't know about cultural variance and neo-Boolean mathematics. You make me feel slow and dense. I have to remind myself I'm not losing my intelligence. You're going forward so quickly, it just looks like I'm slipping backwards.
Must we talk here?
No.
Alice, I need someone to talk to.
And when I needed someone, where were you?
It's not you. It's me. This way that I feel.
And what about the way that I feel? I don't care if your IQ is 185. Or has it gone up since I last saw you. You don't understand me. How I feel, or what I feel, or why I feel. I just don't want to see or talk to you now, Charlie. I'm sorry. I shouldn't upset you. You've got to go to the convention and you'll be under a strain.
But you'll have to see me there at the convention.
I'm not going. I called Professor Niemer and I told him today. I wouldn't want to spoil it for you, Charlie. There will be interesting, intelligent people you can really talk to.
and you'll be in the spotlight.
Alice, you've got to help. Whatever I've accomplished, you've had a big part in it.
I'll just feel like I'm in the way. No matter what you say, I know that's how I'll feel. No more, Charlie. We need time and distance to think out whatever this is. So, if you don't mind, I'll stay home and hang on to my splintering ego. Have a good time, Charlie. There's my bus.
He's not my real brother. My mama told me. He's just a boy we took in because we felt sorry for him. How silly. Charlie doesn't really belong here.
Presentation really needs no introduction. We've all heard about the starting experimental work at Bingen University, sponsored by the Wilbur Foundation and under the direction of Professor Helen Niemann and Dr. Lestrange. This is the report we've all been anxious to hear. So, let me turn the meeting over to Dr. Lestrange.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is a great moment in my life, because
that chairman, why didn't he just say, hey, step right up, see the side show.
Shh.
See, the white mouse is performing Cora, change your genius before your very eyes, and the price. A thin drum and a tenth of a neurosis.
Stop it, Charlie, this is a big moment.
For whom?
Please don't worry, Charlie. There are movies.
You never told me I was being filmed. Why are they laughing? That is a man in torment.
Quiet. Before Charlie came to us, he was a man outside of society, without friends or relatives, without the mental equipment to live a normal life. He had no past, no connection with the present, and no hope for the future. It might be said that before this experiment, Charlie Gordon did not really exist. And now, may I present to you my colleague, Professor Harold Niemann.
Excuse me, Charlie. How dare you? I am a human being with relatives and family and friends than I was before.
Exactly, but at the peak of intelligence so far, Algernon occasionally, well, he varies. He sometimes refuses to work, and other times he'll solve a problem, but instead of taking his reward, he'll hurl himself against the wall of the maze.
You never told me that. It's very important.
But we believe this behavior to be unique to Algernon, as it never occurred in any of the other mice.
That's because none of the other mice ever achieved this level of, intelligence, or held it as long.
Not now, Charlie.
So, we have every reason to believe that Algernon's cure and Charlie's will be permanent. You may ask how I have achieved that, but I have achieved it by statistical evaluations based on earlier experiments. You see, normally dull mice, made normally intelligent, retained that condition for their lifespan. The only difference is here that with Algernon, we were vastly more successful, and Charlie's intelligence has increased to a genius level.
That doesn't prove anything. Your conclusions are premature.
What do you mean?
It's one thing for mouse's intelligence to have a minor increase for a lifespan, but in a case where person's intelligence has been increased majorly,
The waiting period must be extended. We've gone up faster, so we may go down faster, way before the end of the lifespan.
Now, in place of a feeble-minded shell, a burden on society and its fears, irresponsible behavior, excuse me, we have a man of dignity and sensitivity, ready to take his place as a contributing member of society.
You don't really know if Algernon's intelligence or mine is permanent, do you?
I don't know what you say. You may have spotted a mistake.
Sorry, Doctor. It's just my superior intelligence.
I should like you all to hear a few words from none other than Charlie Gordon. Come on, Charlie.
Well, now that we've got ourselves in an apartment, let's get back to work.
June 16th, our escape hit the papers yesterday. The Daily News had an old picture of me and a sketch of a white mouse. Man, why, moron genius and mouse go berserk. Inside, there was a picture of my mother. Seems my father left her years ago. He has a barbershop in the Bronx. Well, he always wanted that. There's an interview with Norma.
We haven't heard from you about 17 years. My mother told me he had been sent to the war. I always thought he died there. And when I was asked to get permission for the operation...
Seeing my mother's picture in the papers, I suddenly hated her. She was two people to me. One who defended, he's a good boy. He's like all the other children. Then, later, when she was sure Norma was... all right. You're bad. Bad, bad. What good would it do to see her now? What could she tell me about myself? Yeah, I am curious. How would she react? Why is it so important for me to say to her, Mom, look at me. I'm normal, better than normal. I'm a genius. July 2nd.
June 20th. Maybe it'd be better if I started with him. It should be simple enough to find a barbershop in the Bronx.
I know what you're going through.
I don't blame you. I'll take him to Hermes tonight. Will that satisfy you?
That's all I ask. I've sacrificed so much in my own life. I'm not going to sacrifice my daughter's too.
We're working on a project together.
I was just worried a bit after that.
Somebody singing Three by Mice, Would You Believe? When I looked, it was Mr. Burns. He couldn't seem to get his key in the lock, but I opened for him.
That.
He acted so funny, I couldn't tell if he was play acting or maybe had a wee drop too much.
No, just youthful high spirits.
What did he do?
Oh, he was acting all funny, like he was a little boy talking about wanting to go to school, learn, to read and write. He was a regular sketch. Oh, and he did say something that his mother wouldn't let him play with some girl. Alice? Because she would put him in a cage, play on the water.
I'm sorry if I disturbed you, Mrs. Mooney. It won't happen again.
No, at my age, you don't sleep so long, Mr. Gordon. And any little thing brings up a long night. Pleased to meet you, miss. As long as you're all right, Mr. Gordon.
Is that why you finally called me?
I called because I wanted to see you. And remember that. Oh, I'm not surprised. He wants to get out. The other Charlie wants to get out.
You can't talk like that.
It's true. Ever since that night at the concert, he's been following me. It's why I haven't been able to see you.
That isn't real. You built it up in your mind.
I can't help feeling like I'm not me. I usurped his place and locked him out. Just like they did to me at the bakery. But what I'm trying to say is that Charlie exists in the past, but the past is real, so he exists.
Charlie, you've got to call Strauss and Meyer to help them. Not only to help yourself, but to help all the others.
Charlie, the little boy who's afraid of women because of the things that his mother did to him, that comes between us.
Charlie, that isn't real.
All these months, while I've been growing intellectually, I still have the emotional wiring of the childlike Charlie. And every time I think of you, of loving you, there's a short circuit.
Charlie, let me help. Let me help. I love you.
How can you? Why should you?
I don't know why. I only know it is.
Charlie doesn't want me to love you.
Priority.
Yes, and the foundation pays the bills.
Indeed. We have everything against us, money and brains. Yes, Charlie?
Doris is taking him through lab equipment and procedures.
And the mouse?
I ran some tests. He's learning things on a much more primitive level.
In what way?
I ran the blind door test 3 times, and he used to solve it by simple patterns, but now he's doing it by trial and error. Could it be because he's been away too long? Can't tell. We'll have to see what happens tomorrow.
I have just seen the freezer and the incinerator.
Good afternoon, Charlie. Welcome back.
Excuse me. Professor Niemann, Dr. Strauss. How are you?
Well, I'm happy to see you. That's how I am.
I suppose I should apologize.
No need. If we didn't understand, then who would?
We are glad. We are glad to have you working with us. Charlie?
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Now, Doris has just explained to me that you freeze the specimens and dispose of them in the incinerator.
We have to. Custom orders to control decomposition.
Not Algernon. I mean, if... When... I just don't want him dumped in there. Please, give him to me. I'll take care of it.
From now on, Charlie, you can have whatever you want.
Thank you. Now, I'd like to get back to work as quickly as... What plans have been made for me?
What do you mean?
I'm on staff now, Professor. I have a right to everything that pertains to this experiment, and that includes my future.
It's taken care of, but don't even think about that.
If I regress.
We have the highest hopes of permanence. We still do. We definitely do.
But if I lose it, what happens to me then?
Charlie, there's so much to do.
Answer me.
There's no telling what will happen to you. Experiences from after the operation may leave a mark on you. Emotional disturbances, you understand. There may be a regression to an even more primitive level of functioning.
That's really letting me have it.
Well, you wanted it.
I did. So, what happens to me then?
You'll be taken care of.
How?
It's arranged.
Tell me how.
The Wellberg Foundation has arranged to... They're sending you to the Warren State Home and Training School.
Warren?
They'll pay for everything, Charlie, so long as you live. Your sister agreed!
I'll bet! Why Warren? I mean, Mr. Donner got me out of there. Why do I have to go back?
If you can take care of yourself, then you won't have to. And there's every reason to believe you'll remain as you are today, but we had to make provision for you, just in case.
Tell me. Is it a possibility to go there?
To Warren?
Look it over as a visitor?
It could be arranged, but why?
Please, Charlie, don't.
I want to. I've got to know what might become of me when I'm still in control enough to be able to do something about it. Please, arrange a visit.
If you insist.
Don't be too upset about it, Doctor. At least it's not the incinerator. I had to know the meaning of my total existence involves knowing my future as well as my past, where I'm going as well as where I've been. And we all know the end of this. this glorious maze holds death, but... I see now that it's the path that I take through the maze. That's what makes me the man that I am. Come in, Mrs. Mooney. It's unlocked.
It isn't, Mrs. Mooney. I've been trying to phone you all night.
Just since 7.
How do you know?
I got home at 6. The phone's been ringing since 7, and I haven't been answering.
Sitting in the dark? Pitying yourself?
Thinking.
Wait, have you been to the lab at all today?
I was there until about 11.
So, you know about Algernon.
I know that he isn't eating. I know that Bert is force feeding him with an eyedropper. I know that as I sat there and watched him struggling underneath those bands, that I felt as if my own arms and legs were tied. And of course I know that I've got to stop identifying with him.
Have you eaten anything at all today?
Checking?
That's not what I meant. I meant... Could I get you some coffee?
No.
We were all worried. Where have you been all day?
Sightseeing.
Sightseeing?
It was a nice day and I thought I'd drive through the countryside. Just have some place to go. I went to the Warren State Home today.
Today?
Mustn't put off till tomorrow. What may become of you tomorrow?
Charlie, you can't let yourself think like that. You've got to get home.
But I don't have home! I just do what I feel is right until the chromosomes tell me what's going to become of me. They worked themselves out.
How was it, Warren?
Practically a country club. Thanks for asking.
Don't be flippant.
They do their best. They are understaffed. There are no guards except for the emotionally disturbed retardates. And the rest of the patients are roughly divided between the tidies and the untidies.
What does that mean?
What do you think it means, Alice? It means they teach the high-functioning morons woodworking while they feed bottles to the less fortunate ones. They are devoted to their patients. They really are. But when I was there, no one said anything about rehabilitation. No one spoke of hope, feeling. Dealing with living death.
Let me do something. What can I do?
Many things. You could comfort me, love me, be my wife. But no. Charlie won't let you. Not me, of course. The other Charlie. The one on the inside who may be on the outside very soon.
What will you do?
I will work as hard, as fast as I can. So many problems to solve. I'm like a kind of research. I may only have a few weeks to do it.
You call me. If you're alone, if you need anything, if you're just sitting in the dark, you'll call me.
No more sitting in the dark. July 11th, note for Bert. Problem with the calculus of variation. Will I be a tidy or an untidy? Calculus of variation. If the intelligence quotient can be divided by the overlaying factors,
me what this is?
Those are more of Charlie's notes.
How many days worth of work is this?
Two.
Dear heaven.
I've hired more stenographers, but it's just so much.
Don't tell me, I've been up to one listening to his tapes.
July 18th. They all think I'm killing myself at this pace, but they don't understand. I'm living at a peak of clarity and beauty I never knew existed. As if all the knowledge I've soaked in during the past months has lifted me to a peak of light and understanding. This is beauty. This is love and truth all rolled into one. This is joy. And now that I've found it, how can I give it up?
It's incredible. I can't believe any person can work at this level, at this pace.
I've read some of this, but of course I don't understand it. Was this work as brilliant as it seems?
Why are you asking me? It may take science 40 years to understand what Charlie's giving us this week.
What have we done? What have we unleashed? What do we do?
We hire another stenographer and tell her to get it all down correctly.
July 25th. Algernon became lost in pace today. He threw himself at the walls, whistling for leaping up. Twice he caught his claws in the mesh of her head, screeching wildly. Then he stopped. He remained, lying for hours in his own dirt. Unmoving.
So, continues and continues.
Now he only seems to care for Algernon.
Understandable.
What do you think is the reason for Algernon's regression?
I tell you the truth, Jay. I've stopped. If there's any explanation whatsoever, Charlie will find it long before I do. I'm going home.
It's only 2 o'clock.
I've got to help my wife. Tonight is her dinner party.
Right. Is Charlie going to be there?
Well, he's been invited. This is an owner of the Wellbergs, and, you know, they've put up the money, so he really should come. If he can take time from his work, that is.
All right, Charlie. I'll see you there, I guess.
7 o'clock. August 25th. It's been a blind alley for about 2 days now. The main problem is, does Algernon's regression affect the basic hypothesis of the experiment? Is the reaction peculiar to him, or is the whole theory false? Where does that leave me? I know that the answer is in here somewhere, but I've got to let it sit for a while. Which is why I've decided to go to Mrs. Neymer's party tonight. Maybe the answer will come to me when I'm not looking for it. Pray God is the answer I want, but if not, I'll accept and be grateful for everything that I've been given. Inviting me to your party, Miss.
It was good of you to come. You know Mr. Harvey from the Wellbeck Foundation?
Yes, of course. I'm more actually now with Charlie's.
No one really starts anything new these days, Mrs. Niemer. They merely build off of other men's failures. What each man contributes to the sum of knowledge is what counts.
Yes, of course. Isn't it a shame Mr. Gordon wasn't here when the project started? Oh, I forgot you weren't in any position to do psychological experimentation then, were you?
There you are, Charlie. I've been looking for you. Excuse me, Mrs. Niemer. Oh, I thought you were about to go off on her.
I wasn't going off on her. I was about to explode on her.
That's a no-no. Mr. Harvey's almost bored.
Well, why was she riding me?
She wasn't riding you. She was being a good wife and telling her husband's boss the good job he's been doing. Why are you so tense?
Don't ask me why I was tense, Bert. If I knew why I was tense, then I wouldn't be tense now, would I?
So this is our Mr. Gordon?
Am I?
You have a best Jackie Melberg, Charlie.
And this is my sister Anne.
We were just talking about money.
Don't we always? Wow, all this scientific stuff is frightfully expensive.
Is it?
Well, it's always hard to find funding for projects like these.
The problem is convincing my board of directors that this kind of research has an ethical value, you know? I started the foundation, but it's not all my money.
But she puts every penny she can spare into it, and she barely contributes to my project.
And what is that exactly?
Well, it preserves. Do you know how many of our Native American birdies are dying out?
No! It seems there are blanks in my education.
Well, for example, there are only 15 whooping cranes left.
I can't believe it. When we start something like this, we could be more certain of the result.
Well, one can never know about the project in advance. Results are often negative, but it's at least valuable to the next researcher who knows what not to do.
I mean, I'm delighted for Mr. Gordon, but is this something the world will really be able to use?
It would be so marvelous for the Foundation's image if we could show there is some tangible good coming out of all of this.
You know something? You are so right. We are hoping to make enough of 5 million retardates in this country intelligent enough to go out and sit on the edge of the last 15 whooping cranes, and increase the population maybe 30 or 40%. Do you think that would improve the image?
Dear Jackie, won't you come and try some of these marvelous cheeses? I've met this wonderful woman in Greenwich Village. She comes with all these pleasant times and was absolutely miracle to give out a kitchen.
Just who do you think you are?
Harold, this isn't the time.
Insulting Miss Wellberg, you are indebted to her, Charlie, if not to us, in more ways than one.
Since when is a guinea pig supposed to be grateful?
So you think that you were better off before the Foundation became interested in you?
In some ways, yes. No one here cares about me. Me, Charlie Gordon, whether he's a moron or a genius. Except insofar as it affects your work. Well, I've served your purpose, and now I'm trying to correct your mistake. But do not ask me for gratitude, Professor Niemer.
You want to feel sorry for yourself! Go away! But do not expect me to feel sorry for you. Our experiment was merely calculated to raise intelligence. And indeed, we had no control over your development from a likable, retarded man to this arrogant, self-centered ingrate!
Yeah! Wanted someone that could be made intelligent and kept in a cage, only to be brought out when you wanted to take some vows!
We did everything we could for you.
Except rape me!
wheels him into that operating room. You doctors and PhDs think that a person with an IQ of less than 100 is expendable. No, we don't matter, but we do.
We?
Yes, we. The other Charlie is here. Still here.
He's out of his head. He's talking. There were two of him.
Sometimes he sees himself as he used to be, as a separate individual, as though he was struggling for possession of.
He's not struggling. He's just waiting. Thank you.
That's it. I solved the problem. Oh my gosh. I've solved the problem!
And Uncle Herman, he'll be so pleased. And wait till your father comes home.
happy to see you.
Mom. There's something I have to give you before I go.
Go? You can't go now.
I must.
Well, when will I see you again?
I don't know. But I wanted you to have this.
What is it?
It's a scientific report I wrote. It's called the Algernon Gordon effect. It's something I came up with, and it's named partially after me.
It's your name. They always laughed at me when I said you'd do good. You were too young to remember, but I told them. Excuse me.
Got a good grade on a test, and she promised you a dog. Only Matt said you couldn't have it because you wouldn't let me play with it.
I don't remember. Was I so mean to you?
One thing I'm curious about, though. I don't remember if it's a dream or a memory or just something I came up with, but you were about 6 or 7. We had lampshades on our heads pretending to be Chinese coolies. You were jumping up and down on the bed. You slipped and bumped your head. It was only a scratch. But you screamed. And that I tried to... She beat me with the strap, but I was really unconscious. Do you remember? Did it happen?
My dream. I remember the lampshades, the mattress. I hated you because they fussed over you all the time. They never spanked you for not bringing home the best marks. And in school, children would scribble things in my books. Moron sister or dummy Gordon family. Then one day, I wasn't invited.
was safe here in the kitchen. You had to face the rest of the world.
Why did they send you away, Charlie? I always wondered, but every time I asked her, she said it was for your own good.
In a way, she was right.
Why did it happen to us, Charlie?
It's past. I'm glad I met you again, Norma.
Charlie? You don't know what a nightmare it's been. All these years with her coming home every night, wondering whether she's harmed herself. I'm glad you're here. I've needed someone.
No, it's okay. I have a little money with what the foundation pays me. I can send you some of it. At least for a while, anyway.
But you're not going away. You've got to stay with us now.
I have to go. Make a few speeches, but I'll be back as soon as I can.
No, Charlie. Don't go. I'm frightened.
It's okay. It's okay, Norma. You don't have to be afraid anymore.
That's it? The computers confirm every detail in this report.
There can be no mistake.
Do you think Charlie could make a mistake? And if we start questioning the computers now, that's the first step back to the Stone Age.
Charlie's analysis was rather good. All right. It was incredible.
Everything about him is incredible, though. Every time I look at him, I get a sort of double vision. Some retarded man who first walked into the operating room and a man who's now not the person denied the line.
The Algernon Gordon effect by Charles Gordon. The simple hypothesis here proved may be summarized in the following terms.
Artificially induced intelligence, the decreases at the rate directly proportional to the quantity of the increase.
You memorize it?
Not consciously. It sticks in my mind.
I am sorry that my own contribution to this assignment must rest upon the ashes of this staff, and especially those who have done so much for me. Signed, Charles Gordon.
It's Algernon!
Ben.
About an hour ago, I found him laying on the side of his cage, like he was running in his sleep.
Was Charlie affected?
Yes, I think he was. He came by with some kind of box.
And the dissection?
Who's Charlie Wright?
We didn't need the computers. We knew Algernon wouldn't let Charlie down.
His brain had decreased in weight compared to a normal brain. There were a general smoothing out of cerebral convolutions and deepening and broadening of brain fissures.
You'll type out a report.
Yeah, tomorrow. But the same thing is happening to him!
The question is, how much can he hold on to?
That's all for today, Charlie.
Whatever information you want from me, you can get from the report.
I understand.
No, no, you don't understand, Bert. I passed your level on the way up, and I'm passing it on the way down. We're just not on the same level anymore.
Do you want me to get Professor Strauss?
No, no, I don't. I just want to sit, just for a minute.
I'll take care of it, Charlie. Bert.
Thank you. Thank you for everything.
It's okay, Charlie.
September 7th, Alice and I, we had an argument, fight, let's see if I can remember. We have the Dunn-Gordon effect. By Charles Gordon. The simple hype. The simple hype.
Try again.
The Algernon-Gordon effect by Charles Gordon. The simple hype. The simple hype.
No, not see Jack, see. It's run, Jack, run. Try again.
Thank you.
is more understanding of people who struggle with any kind of mental challenge, and even we thought about Alzheimer's and that struggle, and we just hope as you go through the Christmas season that you really think about how you treat other people and how you respect them. Thank you. Because I could not go to their country and perform a play, so I give them a lot of credit.